Blog Talk Radio.
For the show that is sweeping the country on Tuesdays. It is the American Sports History Podcast, hosted by a brother, a mentor, and a friend, Peter Ray, out of Cleveland, Ohio. Yours truly producing it, Mark Mancini in Los Angeles, 2,500 miles to the west, 347-205-9631. If you happen to miss it, 30 minutes goes by quick. Catch the archive version on blogtalkradio.com/Mancini Sports. Podcast platforms, wherever you subscribe to the podcast, powered now by Mancini Media. So without further ado, more of him, less of me, let me lay the red carpet down, put the podium in its place, hand off the mic, the threes, Peter. How are you? How can people get a hold of you? And boy, I always said this, when God created women, the world was definitely complete. Take it away, my friend, as I man the board.
Hi, Mark. I'm doing well. I have a YouTube channel. It's my name, Peter, J.REA, and you're absolutely right. Tonight, Joe Charbonneau had to cancel at the last minute, but we have a pinch hitter who's been coming on for the second time, a lady who has so much energy, intelligence, and creativity. She's in the World Martial Arts Hall of Fame for Taekwondo, Kung Fu, and Wushu. She was involved in a Super Bowl commercial with The Rock. She's worked as a stunt person. And tonight, and she's got a, she actually has a series of books. She's a successful high fantasy author. The series called Birth of the Fae, and a lot, which include Locked Out of Heaven, Thine Eyes of Mercy, From the Ashes, Kingdom Come, A Fae Is Done, a novella, Fire, Ice, Acid, and Heart, and then coming out June 16th, Forgive Us. Welcome to the show, the amazing Danielle M. Orsino.
Hi, Peter. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so super excited to be back, a returning guest. I feel very special.
Oh, wow. I mean, I just find you an incredible person, and especially this you're into different things. I know you have a podcast. You have an NFL podcast with Mark Mancini and his network. But I'm really intrigued by your work and success as a high fantasy author, and because that's really incredible. You want to talk about your new book coming out, "Forgive Us," and the Birth of the Fae series?
Yes, I'm so excited. This is actually the end to volume one. "Forgive Us" comes out June 16th. Published by Four Horsemen Publications, and it's the end of volume one, not the end to the Fae series. So nobody get any ideas out there. I'm coming back, but it is the end to volume one. So this ends our time in the Vale, which is the dimension where my Fae live. This is going to end the time there for now before we move on to a new story. But it's kind of the conclusion to everything that I've been building up, all the political intrigue, all those loose ends and the Easter eggs I've dropped throughout the series. all come together here, and yet I still leave it on a cliffhanger because I love to do that to my readers.
When did Locked Out of Heaven come out, the first book?
The first edition came out in 2019, and then I left my first publisher, and Four Horsemen came in and scooped me up, and I started writing with them, and then the second edition came out actually in 2021, and that included the deleted prologue that the first publisher didn't want me to add, and Four Horsemen was like, no, definitely add it. So it had all like the little deleted scenes that I was super excited to put in, and then Thine Eyes of Mercy came right out, right on the tails of Locked Out of Heaven, like I think just 3 months. And then I just started kind of releasing pretty quick and then pulled back a little bit to give the readers, you know, a breath. Because, like I said, I like to leave things on cliffhangers, but I don't want to pull a George R.R. Martin and have everybody waiting years in between books. I don't like to do that. So I spaced it out, but, you know, still gave people time to get into the world a little bit.
Well, can you give us an overview of this whole series about the main characters, the setting, and so forth?
Sure. The series is based on the idea that there are angels who were sent here on Earth to create and get the Earth ready for the Creator's next great experiment, which the rumor between the angels was that it was things called humans. And they don't know what's going to happen. They were just told, get the Earth ready. And I'll kind of fill you in from there with what the Creator said to them. So there's two factions of angels. There's the Virtue Angels, which are these elite angels that are just under archangels. They are nature angels. They're, you know, there's river angels and elemental angels, and they're just set to get the planet ready. The next group of angels are the lower faction, and they're the Power Brigade. They're kind of the foot soldiers of the archangels, and they're the ones who fight Lucifer and do all the dirty work. So they're both on the planet at the same time, and they both think they're going to go back to the Shining Kingdom when their job is done, and then one day everything goes silent. The whole planet just kind of stops. And they cannot go home. The gates close. They don't know why. Lucifer's horde is pulled back. The Shining Kingdom closes, and they're just stuck here. They're not given any reason, nothing. It just goes silent. And so now they have to figure out, what do we do? Their wings start to decay. All these things start to happen, and they're just left quiet. So the book takes it through. The whole series goes from them being stuck and figuring out, okay, what are our identities, which I think we can all kind of at some point identify with. You know, what happens when you lose your job and all of a sudden your whole life was built into your job and you don't have it anymore. And so it goes from that to figuring out, okay, we're not angels anymore. What are we? And then humans populate the Earth and they have to figure out, okay, what are we to these humans? So it goes from the beginning of time straight through. Book 6, Forgive Us, ends in about the 16th century, and we see how the angels who call themselves Fae, my readers and my friend C.R. Rice has actually said Fae stands for fallen angels on Earth. In the book, it stands for fellow Aegis of Earth, the defenders of Earth, the fellowship of Earth, what they've become, and they in turn figure out human worship equals power. So they become your polytheistic gods and goddesses to us. All the legends and myths of the Roman, Greek, Egyptian gods and goddesses, that's what the Fae are to humans. And so they develop their own identity, and we see how they kind of play in human history. And we see the whole thing develop and into, you know, what the political games are within their own kingdoms at the court of light and dark. So it's kind of just a play on what happens when you have to reinvent yourself. How do you pull yourself up by the bootstraps?
So do these books, series of books, take place on Earth?
Yes, the whole thing takes place on Earth. They don't go home. They build a whole new life on Earth, and we see how these Fae play in primitive humanity all the way up through Tudor England and beyond into the plagues of London. So it's a little bit of alternative history and things that historical events that humans know were really fey events and how humans interpreted them. And we kind of see how both sides play into it.
And is a fey an angel?
They're not. They were angels. They're not angels anymore. They lose their wings. They lose all their angelic glory is gone because they are cut off from the Shining Kingdom. So they reinvent themselves. Some of the fey who were angels who were maybe sent here to like take care of deer. You know, they have like very specific animals that they're supposed to guard. They bond with. Some of them bond with trees, and they become what we know as dryads, which, you know, in human legends, you know, were tree goddesses. So some of them choose to bond with their wards. Some keep what is left of their angelic looks. So they may look tall and lit. And some, like I said, choose to bond, and we learn where mermaids come from and different creatures that we know in mythological lore. We learn where they come from. And, you know, so it's not just the idea of, oh, they were just always here. Mermaids were always here. Dryads were always here. Gnomes were always here. We learn that these were actually angels who decided to bond with their wards and become what they look like. So we have the Aubane faction, who are full of these white deer with these gilded antlers. They were once angels who decided to bond with the deer and become the most expressive, beautiful form of them. And then protect them while they're on Earth.
So, do some of the Fae look like humans?
They appear like humans. They're just a lot taller. They're a lot taller. They're bigger. They kind of have an aura about them that would be otherworldly. But if they go into the human dimension, I have in Thine Eyes of Mercy, I have a fae named Awen. He's a Bishop Awen. He's an advisor to Queen Aurora. He needs to go and visit Queen Mary's court, Queen Mary the First, because the fae have a contract with her. So he's tasked with going to make sure that she abides by the contract. So when he goes, he has to tone down his look, because if he walked into Queen Mary's court sparkling and being Awen, they'd be like, whoa, you don't look like the rest of us. So he tones it down. He's not as tall. You know, he uses a little bit of magic to keep his looks more human-like and, you know, not stand out as fae-like, because his aura is so strong, because the fae are so connected to the earth and the electromagnetic energies within the earth. Their chakras are all in line. They tend to, for lack of a better word, I don't want to say sparkle because people are like, oh, twilight, but they give off a certain energy. So they tone it down when they're around the humans, and they can glamour to look different ways and shift. So they will do that around humans so they don't give them all of their fainess and their glory.
So you're going through history in these books, world history.
Yes, I go through history. I did extensive studying. More than I ever thought I would, especially for Tudor England, because a lot of books, you know, they take, you know, everybody loves King Henry VIII. They want to talk about Anne Boleyn. They want to, you know, go through his wives. And I didn't want to do the usual aspect and just kind of drill that home. I felt like it had been done before. So I wound up going with Queen Mary the First, because it's either Elizabeth or Henry that everybody kind of talks about. So I wound up going with Queen Mary. So what I did was I took actually a course on Tudor etiquette and the etiquette of that time to make sure that I could capture it as best I could. So when they all go to eat, it's pretty legitimate. You know, they ate family style when they were in court. They actually carried their utensils in a pouch, in a leather pouch on their hip to show their wealth. You would wash your hands in rose water before you sat at the table to show you were clean. Your napkin went on the left side of your shoulder. There were little things like that that I put in the book to make it as authentic as possible and give those moments. I even wrote the first manuscript. Most of what happened, the conversation in Tudor time, I wrote in Old English, and my editor threw it out because she was like, nobody's going to understand this. She's like, I'll give you a couple dies, thous, privies. She's like, and that's it. She's like, the rest has got to go, because I was trying to make it so authentic for everybody. Nobody could have read it. But I was really, you know, I was trying to be, to show that I really took time. I mean, down to how Queen Mary would actually change. She would keep breeches and men's clothing stuffed in a log. So when she would ride side saddle and do the whole queenly woman thing. And then when she got out of eyesight, she would take it off and ride more like a man, regular, because she didn't want to ride side saddle. She hated it. So I did I put little things like that to make it as realistic as possible.
Are you planning for this series to come to the present day?
Yes, actually, Volume 2 takes place in present day. So I am planning on that, and it does still have that alternative history feel. Volume 2 is from about 2002 to the present day, and it deals with the Libyan chemical inspections that took place with the U.S., and that's kind of where it starts. And then we move it forward. But even then, there's some alternative history, maybe dealing with a certain presidential assassination attempt and then a certain presidential assassination. We have all of those things kind of going on. We have some clandestine CIA agencies that are supernatural involved and interesting things like that. So I'm really excited for Volume 2, also because the gentleman who inspired this whole series, the patient that I told the story to originally that set me down this path, his literary persona, his, you know, his hero persona is actually the protagonist of Volume 2. So I'm really, really excited for everybody to get their hands on Volume 2 and start that next journey.
Well, your new book, Forgive Us, when does that end?
Forgive Us actually does end. It's so funny. Forgive Us ends midway through the book. I end in the veil. We kind of tie everything up. And then I have these little short stories that take us from a small village in France all the way up to New York City, Sotheby's, I think 2005. And it ends with Agent Graham, who is the hero of the next series. So everybody gets to meet him, and it does end in the 21st century. So I think it's kind of cool that...
Forgive Us takes us to pretty near recent time.
Yes. Forgive Us takes us right up to that.
So how about Locked Out of Heaven? Is that when does that take place?
Locked Out of Heaven is the beginning of time. It's right when the planet is brand new. And everybody is getting it ready. It's actually the prologue of Locked Out of Heaven is Lucifer and Gabriel fighting before the war between the Creator and Lucifer. It's really way back. We go way back in Locked Out of Heaven. So we start dead in the beginning of everything.
How about Thine Eyes of Mercy? When does that take place?
That is Tudor England. That is Tudor England, right? Queen Mary's reign first begins. And it ends right before her reign ends. I think she has about 3 years left when Thine Eyes of Mercy ends. About that.
How about From the Ashes? When does that take place?
From the Ashes From the Ashes is in between... the end of Queen Mary's reign and the beginning of Queen Elizabeth.
The current, recent Queen Elizabeth?
No, Queen Elizabeth the First.
Okay. How about Kingdom Come?
Kingdom Come, we're still kind of getting through that. It's still pretty right on the heels of getting through Elizabeth's reign.
And how about
very
A Fae Is Done?
A Fae Is Done is very close to that, but we're starting to pick up. We're about in the end of the 14th century.
So you go way back, and then you kind of jump. Is there a jumping between one and two in time?
Yes,
and then you spent a lot of time.
A lot.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then you're in like what, the Middle Ages for most of these?
I kind of hang out in that anywhere between the 14th to 15th century.
Uh-huh.
I hang out there, and then when you get to Forgive Us, that's where the time starts to pick up. I go from that 15th century, and then all of a sudden it's 15th century, and then that takes you actually straight through to even to Victorian England. We go right through, and there's actually circa dates through it, right through it. I mean, we go to Rasputin, the whole thing. The end stories all have little dates in there, so they tell you exactly where you're at after you finish the last chapter. It then goes into the short vignettes, and it's you start in France from 1560 to 1660, and then you go into it jumps a couple years, and then it's the next character. So each character in the end, there's a set of characters that get their own short story. So you go from three characters who kind of share 100 years, and then you jump to Johann and Lotta. They're in England, circa 1900. You go to Rasputin in Russia in 1918, and then you end actually with Graham in Sotheby's, actually in 2015. So it takes you up pretty close, but as you travel, it's kind of cool because we have these sketches that the typesetter did, and the sketches actually change the type of artwork along with the time. So the reader can follow along, and they get a sense of how the times are changing. But that's kind of how we bring it into the 21st century.
How many books will be in Volume 2?
Volume 2 will only have 3 books because as soon as we end in Volume 2, we're going to go back to the Vale, and that's where the culmination of both worlds meet. So up to this point, it's the Vale, and, you know, they've kind of jumped back and forth a little bit with humans, but it's been somewhat separated. Volume 2, it's very separated. You know, it's just, you're just dealing with Graham and Morgan, you know, and we're kind of learning a little bit more, and the humans are finding out they really didn't know much about the Fae. The end of Volume 2, the worlds start to collide. And then Volume 3 will pick up with, this is the consequences of everything. And so then it'll be longer.
And so the Fae are these, would you say that they are beings that are trying to be helpful and positive and beneficial?
Some of them are, yes. I would say some of them are. I think what it is that what started out, Queen Aurora, who started the Court of Light, very much was all about being positive. She wanted to help the humans, and that was her mission, because she really did feel that she understood what it was like to be abandoned. So she really went in with the best of intentions. King Jarvok, who is the king of the Court of Dark, could care less. He's not really worried about the humans. He doesn't necessarily want to hurt anybody. But to him, it's humans are incidental. He's not worried about them. He doesn't want to hurt anybody. But if they get in his way, he thinks nothing of, you know, getting rid of one. They're there for worship and power, and that's it. The rest of the Fae all kind of have different views of humans. You know, they're just, some of them are like, yeah, cool, I'll help you out, but it's almost like they're pets. They're lower beings to them. Aurora really went in with a good heart, and she was like, yeah, I'm going to help them, because I know what it's like. But she also saw it as a way to process her own hurt from the abandonment. And that's more of what a lot of the themes are in the books, is that do you take hurt And do you channel it into helping others, or do you process it and then help? She kind of took it, stuffed it all down, and went, no, I'm just going to help everybody. I'm not going to worry about me. It was kind of that attitude of when you're on a plane, you know, instead of putting her own mask on first and then helping the others, she put everybody else's mask on and forgot that she should put hers on. King Jarbok, on the other hand, did something else.
We have a number of comments. Albert from Poway, California. Hey, Peter, great guest. I have heard her before. Danielle gets right to the point. Lance from Pensacola, Florida. Another great show as always. Keep the women coming, Peter. Hi, Danielle. Have heard your show. It's tremendous. You keep Mark Mancini in line. Robin from Warren, Ohio. Another Tuesday, another amazing day. Peter, you are the comfort of Cleveland. Oh, thank you, Robin. Your words just hit the point. Thank you for what you're doing every week. Hi, Danielle. So nice to see you here. Book writing has got to be hard. Steve from Corvallis, Oregon. What we have here is the New York Giants and Cleveland Browns. Who is defending Odell Beckham Jr.? Sal from Germantown, Pennsylvania. Another great show in a country these days. Thank you, Peter and Danielle. She is good. Found myself intrigued by your description of, because I'm a historian, I think, well, I should probably try reading book one and give it a shot, because I haven't been reading fiction for a long time. I tend to read straight history, but do you think there's any truth in what you've been writing?
I think it's funny that you say that. I've had a couple people ask me that. I think there could always be some truth in it. I've kind of joked about that before. I do think, you know, it's always left up to interpretation. So, you know, there could always be a little bit of truth in it. I don't put that aside. I mean, you know, I joke that I've even snuffed the Loch Ness Monster into the books and made up, you know, why he's there. So there could always be something in there. I think the most truth in the books is that when I write fiction, I take it from the attitude of all it is interpersonal dynamics. Whether I put scales and a horn on it, it's still just the idea of people connecting with people. And I think we can all kind of see the truth in that. So who knows? It could all be there, but it's just how you look at it.
Well, I find it interesting because, you know, with history, you wonder, I've wondered, and I've heard, for example, there is the struggle of good and evil. We know there's good and evil. But then, and I also think that there are, they call them white hats and black hats. And I think, like, right now in the world, there is this big struggle, and there are powerful people behind the scenes who are unseen, who are fighting.
Mm-hmm.
And then they are, and what's really important is public opinion and public morality. So the public has this role to play. And so, anyway, what your book. I find it interesting that there have been, and I think, you know, you could say God and Satan are these sort of invisible forces, and then beyond that, angels and demons, sort of working for either of them, and then sort of unseen, you tend to see history of like these famous people did these things, but I do think there are things happening behind the scenes that are not recorded in history. And so that kind of seems like what you're getting into here.
Yeah, I kind of play with that, and that's the idea, is that nothing is all good, nothing is all bad. You know, even Aurora has the problem with her bishops. These are her advisors, and you see the political intrigue, and the guys that are supposed to be good, are they really good? Just like the Court of Dark. Just because they're the Court of Dark, they're not bad. Everybody thinks they're doing what they need to do for their kin. And I always, you know, liken Jarbok to Magneto from the X-Men. You know, you might not agree with his methods, but he really thinks he's doing what's right for his kin based on what he's experienced. It all comes down to what the other one has experienced and how they interpret it. And that's really what's happening. And it happens especially with Thine Eyes of Mercy and what Queen Mary's been through. And, you know, it's just about everybody's experiences and how that molds their point of view and thus their actions. And, you know, there's a debate in book one called Empathy for the Devil, where Zion and Asa of the Court of Dark debate, is the devil as bad as he says, as we're being told he is, because he took his horde back before the gates were locked, and his whole horde is safe. but yet we who fought for the court of love, for the court, the shining kingdom, are stuck here on earth and we're abandoned. Who is the father of lies? And they wind up debating, having this whole debate of, you know, are we really being told the whole story? And so, you know, it's kind of interesting to go back and forth on this. And I've had, a couple people do that where they kind of go back and say it. And it's something that when the truth does come, the truth comes out between the two courts, they debate all over again of, you know, putting down their armor. Why are they doing it? And that's something that I take apart in Thine Eyes of Mercy, because you never see that side of a king and a queen debating a truth and why they're doing it. You see Jarvok's point of view when he's like, I could demolish her, but this is what will happen to my side if I do. If I keep this war going, this is how it's going to suffer. And you see him mull it over. And so you kind of see, was he really that bad? Okay, maybe he's got some bad pieces, but why? So it's kind of, that's what I try to do in the books, is give you the other side rather than just in most fantasy books sweeping wars. Anybody can write a battle scene, but can you get into the character's head and make somebody feel for the guy who in book one demolished all these people? That's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah, I find it interesting because, like, in history, we tend to be simplistic and we're looking for heroes and villains, and you wonder, those who've been considered or history is described as heroes or villains, and you wonder, wonder if it's true, if maybe those who were depicted as villains were heroes and vice versa. Anyway, what a fascinating interview tonight. Our guest has been Danielle M. Orsino, who is the author of this series of books. What's the name of the series of books?
The series is Birth of the Fae.
Birth of the Fae. Yeah, and you got a new one coming out. Wow, fascinating. We've ran out of time tonight, Danielle. Do you have any final words for our audience?
Everybody can check it out on Amazon or check out birthofthefae.com. Check me out on Instagram, Birth of the Fae. And then you can check it out. Also, I have a video game, an AR game coming out, Los the Dragon, Adopt Your Own Dragon. You can check it out on birthofthefae.com for more information.
Wonderful, wonderful interview with Danielle M. Orsino. Thank you so much for coming on the show, Danielle.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Wonderful. And next week, we're going to have Bill North again, the center fielder, won two World Series with the Oakland A's, tremendous base stealer. Dear listener, may the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Good night, everybody. Thanks again so much, Danielle M. Orsino.
Thank you.
Thank you.